This is a World War II victory garden. Thanks to the recent pandemic, the term victory garden is having a resurgence as some worried Americans are looking for ways to cut costs and avoid exposure during lockdown. Others are hoping to reclaim a sense of calm and normalcy by harkening back on what many think of as a simpler time for America. A time when our parents, grandparents, and great-grandparents stood shoulder to shoulder and made personal sacrifices to assist with the war effort by taking the burden off farmers and growing their own food. It's a lovely image, one certain to speak to many of us frustrated by those incapable of simply staying home or wearing masks. It's hard not to long for a time when Americans came together to help their communities survive. Only that picture isn't 100% accurate. The Victory Garden movement was indeed amazing, but not because it saved a nation from starvation or even eased a burden on farmers. Instead, the real success of the Victory Garden was how it gave a worried nation a much-needed distraction and a sense of purpose during troubling times. While many of us associate Victory Gardens with images of World War II, they first appeared in the U.S. during the First World War. This is Charles Lathrop Pack. Think of him as an early 1900s version of Warren Buffett. Pack came from a long line of timbermen and was the fifth wealthiest man in America during World War I. In 1917, he took it upon himself to find a way to grow the U.S.'s food supply without increasing the need for hiring laborers or purchasing new acres of land. What he came up with was the idea of the Victory Garden. At its core, the concept is simple. Inspire average Americans, who have little to no experience in farming, to go outside and till up whatever small patch of land they have access to. It ended up being quite a popular program, but thanks to our country's immense farmland and the fact that our involvement in the Great War lasted just over a year, we were never in any real danger of starving as a nation. Numerous citizens participated in this gardening push, but the numbers were nowhere near those of the Second World War. Fast forward to 1942, and the concept of the Victory Garden is dusted off and presented to the public again. Of course, America continued to not be in any real danger of starvation thanks to a well-planned rationing program and the continued success of the country's agricultural industry. Certainly, the Dust Bowl of the 1930s had damaged our reserves, but the U.S. had come back on top by the time it had entered the war in 1941. Places like the United Kingdom had a greater emergency need for Victory Gardens, thanks to the Nazis endangering supply lines in the island country. But the National Garden Bureau, or NGB, still felt it important to publish the Victory Garden Manual, encouraging citizens to dig for victory once more. Soon, cities like Boston, Chicago, San Francisco, and New York began to till up every available inch of land for their residents. Even the White House broke ground on a small garden after being inspired by the young daughter of one presidential advisor. By the end of 1942, seed sales had jumped 300%. Corporations, of course, leapt to the chance to be associated with something positive for a war effort, and soon you saw free victory seeds being attached to the sales of all sorts of products. Imagine Nike happily throwing two packets of corn seeds with every purchase of sneakers. In return, these corporations received tax breaks from the government for supporting the war effort. Likewise, huge amounts of both private, state, federal, and local money went into advertising gardens, all pushing the idea that a victory garden at home could save the boys overseas. This isn't to say that it was all a ploy from the corporations preying upon the average American's sense of patriotism and worry for their loved ones. There was one very important reason the U.S. government sought to inspire the masses to get their hands dirty. Anxiety. One concern was that an idle public so far from the front lines may begin to get restless of war. They may begin to feel powerless when responding to the constant deluge of newsreels depicting battles and telegrams about neighbors and sons passing away. Simply put, gardening was seen as a way to give a worried people something to divert nervous energy into, and moreover, it gave them something to be proud of. And to that end, Victory Gardens really worked. It's estimated that 2/3 of American households answered the call to grow their own food by the end of 1942. Close to 20 million families planted 7 million acres of gardens and brought in 15 billion pounds of fresh fruit and vegetables. Clearly, Americans had stepped up and busied themselves with the hard work of growing your own food, and in turn revealed that the government's plan to alleviate a frustrated nation's feelings of helplessness through a sense of purpose had worked. And perhaps that's why Victory Gardens are back. In a way, the country is at war, only this time it's against a disease. Our farmlands are once again holding their own, and thanks to automation and modern science, they'll likely do fine. But many of us have been asked to stay home, and with isolation comes worry. The anxiety that concerned our government during World War II is back and in full force, so what better way to deal with it than tap into the nostalgia and bring back the Victory Gardens? The question is, will America's love for its past and the peace we feel when gardening be enough to carry us through another crisis and unite us once more?